Hi everyone, my name is Sirisha. I am working as a physics lecturer in Tribal Welfare Degree College, Women's Kottagudam. And today I am going to discuss about historical aspects of an atomic model. Why do I chose this topic means here every student has to know the basic knowledge of an atomic model. It means he has to know or she has to know what is an atom, what is an atomic model, how atom is made up of and why it is important. So everyone has to know why they are important. For that reason, I am making this session to understand in a simpler way what is an atomic model. And so here all think that why atomic model is very important. Why atomic model is very important is nothing but atomic models are used to visualize what is an atom and what is a molecule and how to predict the properties of matter. Means atomic model used to give a chance of an estimation of an properties of matter, how they develop. So in this way, it is very important to know what is an atomic model. For that reason, we are going to discuss historical aspects of an atomic model to know the basic knowledge of it. Because physics success is nothing but to know the basic concepts what we have to apply in our future. So here it comes as why atomic models are important. Atomic models are important because they visualize the interior of atoms, they visualize the interior of molecules and thereby predicting properties of matter. I said that atomic models used to say or estimate the properties of matter which was used. So that's why they are important. Let's start. Yes, in this session I am going to start about John Dalton theory, J.J. Thomson, Rutherford, Bohr atomic models. I am going to discuss about these four atomic models in this session. And here, first one is John Dalton atomic theory, which is also called as billiard ball model. B-I-L-L-I-A-R-D, billiard ball model. I will discuss what is billiard. And next, J.J. Thomson model is also called as plum pudding model. And third one is Rutherford atomic model, which is named as Rutherford, and Bohr atomic model, which is named as Bohr atomic model. So they are which was named as Bohr atomic model. And here we have to know what is the previous concept to develop an atom. So what is that? Ancient Greek philosophers said that, and they gave idea is that matter is made up of tiny particles. So as we know that matter are of three types, solids, liquids and gases, and these matter is composed of very tiny particles. So they gave this idea, and that Greek philosophers here are Leucippus and his pupil Democritus, his student. So here they gave one word, what is that means? Atomos. Atomos is nothing but uncuttable or indivisible. What is meant by uncuttable or indivisible? Yes, I can make a large particle, it is an example, I can make a large particle into two particles, two particles into four particles and four into six particles. And later on, what will happen if I cut the particle into continuously, they'll may come up with as many tiny particles, and that tiny particles are called as atomos, and they are very tiny particles. How we will resemble? That's the reason they said that matter is made up of particles. And they introduced one word that is called as atomos. Atomos is nothing but uncuttable or indivisible. And here, they said with an idea, they said that iron is made out of iron particles. And next, cheese is made up out of cheese particles. They gave this idea, but there is no theory of proof and there is no experiment to this theory. As they said, only with an idea, and that is a totally a blind guess. They said that matter is made up of particles, but they didn't give any theory. What is the use? They didn't give any experiment explanation. What is the use? So, but what is the use? I am saying here, just this atom was carried forward to develop an atomic model. This is the hypothesis we'll follow. We will follow in science. Whether it may be a wrong or right, what we'll take the previous knowledge to develop a new hypothetical model. So here atomos is the word which is used to develop all the theories from now on. So this is about the atomos. Next, by taking the model of atomos, means it is not model, it's just a blind guess, but that word comes up into a development. So John Dalton theory said, and his theory is proposed in the year, his theory was proposed in the year 1808, and Dalton was an English physicist, and his lifetime is from 6th September 1766 to 27th July 1844. And I said that Dalton atomic model is also called as billiard ball model. So what is billiard ball model? Let's look into this diagrammic representation. So here we know that snooker's game, billiard ball games. What is snooker's game? A rectangular table will be there. On that table, a number of balls will be there, and there is a cue, means it is a stick which is used to attack that ball, and that ball goes to fell on a will fall on a one round, which is a hole, and that becomes a goal. And this is the game, billiard ball game. And he said that ball as his atomic model, and that model is called as billiard ball model. So billiard ball model is I'm just saying for this example, if you will understand, it will help for you. So Dalton atomic model is also called as billiard ball model. And according to his theory, he said that all matter composed of a very small particles. All matter are composed of very small particles which are indivisible, means uncuttable. As he took that word from the Greek philosophers, they are indivisible. Indivisible means they are uncuttable. So uncuttable. So that tiny particles are called as atoms. But this theory fails. Why this theory fails means it doesn't distinguish about different types of particles. Yes, we are reading today about an electron, proton and neutron. These are the subatomic particles. But at that time, he said only the matter is made up of tiny particles and they are called as atoms. And he didn't said about the types of particles. So that's why this theory fails. But let's look on what his postulates. Yes, his postulates are, first one, he said that all matter are composed of tiny particles, whether an element or a compound, they are made out of with tiny particles. That tiny particles are called as atoms. They are indivisible. They can be created nor be destroyed, as energy cannot be created nor be destroyed. In the same way, they are indivisible because they are tiny particles. We can't touch them. So they can't be created nor be destroyed. And this is one postulate. And he said that all atoms of same element contains same mass, same size and same chemical properties. What it means, if I took this two elements, what the elements means? Ferrous elements. Ferrous elements contain same mass, same size and same chemical properties. But he said another point also. What is that? He said that atoms of different elements contains different mass, different size and they have different chemical properties. I said that. For example, if I took elements of two elements, sulfur and ferrous, what will happen? The ferrous is differ from sulfur, its masses differ from sulfur, its sizes differ from sulfur, it contains different chemical properties than sulfur. So this is what he was said. Next, he said that, as I already said, atoms are indivisible particles, they can't be created nor be destroyed. He said, when two elements combine together, they lead to forming a new one, and that new one is named as compound. For example, if oxygen atom is going to combine with the hydrogen atom, what will happen? It leads to form a new one, that is H2O, which is called as water. So he said one more point, that is, when oxygen is going to combine with hydrogen atoms, they lead to form a new compound, it's okay, but they behave themselves as they done before. It means what, ma'am? It means oxygen atoms behaves like oxygen atoms only. Hydrogen atoms behaves like hydrogen atom only. It means after combination of these two elements, we will think that why don't oxygen behave as hydrogen? Hydrogen behaves as oxygen, but they contains different chemical properties. It is 16 mass in number. They are 2 mass in number. Why I am saying 2 means we are using 2 hydrogen atoms. 1 mass in number for hydrogen. So the combination of 2 elements leads to a compound. But after the combination also, they will follow their rules only. It means oxygen doesn't behave like an hydrogen atom. Hydrogen atom doesn't behave like as an oxygen atom. So this is the thing what happened in the postulates of Dalton theory. And these are the postulates of Dalton theory. First one is atoms are indivisible particles. Second one is atoms are made up of tiny particles. Third one is atoms of same element contain same mass, same size. Atoms of different element contains differ in size and mass. And here he said that they are indivisible particles and they can be created, they cannot be created nor be destroyed. He said that after the combination of two elements leads to form a compound, and it doesn't, he said that that oxygen behaves like oxygen molecule, oxygen atom, and hydrogen behaves like an hydrogen. They doesn't behave like an another atom of other element after the combination. So this is about the postulates of Dalton theory. And next, drawbacks of Dalton theory. So according to his theory, atoms are indivisible, but later on we have some atomic particles. They are called electron, proton and neutron. So this is one drawback. And according to his theory, all atoms of same elements contain same mass, but we have the concept of isotopes later on. What is meant by isotope? It means the same chemical element contains different mass numbers. Example I gave here, carbon. Carbon contains 12, 13, 14. Means same chemical element contains different atom, different mass number, nothing but isotope. So this is got wrong. His postulate one got wrong. This is the one drawback for him. And next one, he said that all atoms of different elements contains different mass, but later on we have one concept is that isobar. What is meant by isobar? Isobar is nothing but the different elements contains same mass number. Different elements contain same mass number. It means, I gave here one example, AR and CA. They contain same mass number as 40. So AR is 40, CA is 40. And its mass number are same, but they are different elements. So these are the drawbacks of Dalton theory, and now we will move to the J.J. Thomson atomic model, and he took up these considerations into his model to develop. But the theory was proposed in the year 1904, and he is also very famous English physicist, and he had two J's are there. We have to know what is two J's. Joseph John Thomson, and his lifetime period is 18 December 1856 to 30 August 1940. And he discovered the first subatomic particle. He discovered by cathode tube experiment. So what is that? He discovered that there is one subatomic particle, and that atomic particle is called as an electron, and he discovered it in the year 1897. And you know that it is very famous. You'll get one small answer question in your intermediate. What is an electron, and who proposed that? Who gave that? So who discovered that? So who discovered, in the sense, J.J. Thomson discovered in the year 1897. And we are going to discuss his atomic model. What is it? Yes, his atomic model is called as plum pudding model. Plum pudding model. Yes, what is it, ma'am? Plum pudding model means what is it? Yes, we'll discuss. Yes, if electrons are embedded with positive charge in a spherical way, means the positive charge is in the spherical way, and that electrons are embedded in it. What it meant, ma'am, we don't understand. It meant for that, for example, if we take a watermelon, then cut it, it will get into the spear shape, right? And he said that the flesh in the watermelon, the red part which we use it to eat, the red part, that red flesh is called as positive charge. The electrons inside it is that seeds in watermelon. That black seeds are considered as electrons, and the red portion, the red flesh of that watermelon, considered as positive charge according to his atomic model. So yes, you'll understand now. What is plum pudding model, ma'am? Watermelon is example for it. What is plum pudding model means? He said that plum is a fruit which is made into a sweet dish, and in that sweet we make a part of raisins, kismis, a raisins, cherries, berries in it. After making a bake of it, what will happen when we cut? We will see all cherries, berries, raisins in it. So that raisins, berries, cherries are called as electrons because they are embedded in it. They kept in them, in that area. And all the portion of that pudding and that plum pudding, outer portion of that area, is called as positive charge. And that one is called as plum pudding model, as like as watermelon. So he said that both positive charge and mass of the atom are distributed uniformly. Positive charge and mass of the atom, because they consider the positive charge as the whole area for which in which electrons are embedded in it. So they considered as, sorry, he considered the positive charge and mass of atom are uniformly distributed. So let's discuss about postulates. See here, I gave example of J.J. Thomson atomic model, watermelon, and that red flesh is called as positive charge, and that seeds present in it are called as electrons. And I already discussed his postulates. What you discussed, ma'am? Yes. Atom resembles as a sphere. Atoms results as a positive charge. Here, the atom resembles as a sphere of positive charge. Which electrons present inside it as watermelon? See here, the electrons, he means the black seeds, are embedded in this watermelon flesh. this model is J.J. Thomson model. And he said that the positive charges is equal to the negative charges. That's why this model is electrically neutral. It means the positive charges is equal to the negative charges. Their magnitude is equal. So he said in this way. So it is also resembles as a plum pudding model, as well as I gave example for watermelon. Now the drawbacks of J.J. Thomson atomic model. J.J. Thomson atomic model failed to explain how positive charge holds electrons in it, and he failed to explain the stability of an atom. He didn't mention about the nucleus inside it. He didn't say about what is nucleus. Actually, he didn't say that what are positive charges and how positive charge holds electrons in it. So these are the J.J. Thomson model limitations. And now Rutherford gold foil experiment. Yes, Rutherford made an experiment by taking J.J. Thomson atomic model. He want to draw the conclusions by J.J. Thomson atomic model. He want to observe what will come through that experiment. But later on, he made a new observations by doing this experiment. So J.J. Thomson already, we discussed drawbacks of them. But here, that drawbacks come up into a new atomic model, that is Rutherford atomic model. That Rutherford atomic model was developed by after doing this experiment. So Rutherford alpha particles used for his experiment. Why he used alpha particles in it? Later on we will know. But we have to know what is alpha particle. Alpha particle is a positively charged particle, and it is a nuclei of helium atom. It is a nuclei of helium atom. And these alpha particles are produced by nuclear disintegration. Disintegration is nothing but breakdown of particles. And this was done in the year 1909. And with the help of his co-workers Hans Geiger and Ernest Marsden. And they used the gold foil in this experiment. What is the thickness of the foil means? It is 8.6 into 10 to the power of minus 6 centimeters. And it is used to take the support of a glass plate in an experiment. We'll discuss some more questions. So here, why alpha particles selected for this experiment means? Yes. Alpha particles are heavier than positive charges and negative charges in J.J. Thomson atomic model. Because he thought that alpha particles are heavier, they'll hit the lightest particles and that doesn't go any deviation, and they go on, they'll go to hit on the fluorescent screen. We'll discuss what is fluorescent screen. So, alpha particles were having high energy and as well as heavier. So what is the mass of alpha particle, ma'am? Yes, mass of the alpha particle is equal to four times of mass of hydrogen. It equals to four times mass of hydrogen. Yes, it is. And next up, what is the charge of alpha particle, ma'am? Yes, the charge of alpha particle is positive charge, and its positive charge is double of proton. As we know that proton is also positive charge, but double of proton positive charge. This is about alpha particle. Madam, why gold foil used for this experiment? Yes, gold foil is a very thin foil. It contains, or it estimate contains only 1000 atoms in it. We know that lesser atoms makes more efficient work. He thought that. So what is fluorescent screen? Fluorescent screen is a screen which made out of zinc sulfide. and it is used to detect the radiation. Actually, the screen in the Rutherford foil experiment is made out of with elements zinc sulfide. So here, the fluorescent screen is useful for to detect the radiations. Let's now discuss about the apparatus of Rutherford. So, apparatus of Rutherford experiment, they are radioactive source which leads to give alpha stream particles, lead bracelet, gold foil, fluorescent screen. Yes, here it is Rutherford experiment. Radioactive source gives a stream of alpha particles which will move through the slit and they will hit the gold foil, and that gold foil used to scatter the particles, and that scatter particles will fall on fluorescent screen which used to detect the radiations or which produce a light flash of it. And this is the theoretical explanations of Rutherford experiment, and these are the apparatus of Rutherford experiment. And next, what they observed by this experiment. Actually, Rutherford want to give the conclusions of J.J. Thomson atomic model, and but he found a new observations. What are they? As he think that when alpha particles is moving to that J.J. Thomson atomic model, all will go on straight. But he found some new observations which he doesn't think. What they are? The particles, some of the alpha particles goes through the gold foil and scattered without any deviation, without any deflection. But some particles got deflection by small angles, with different angles, the things. And next, few alpha particles are rebounded. Few alpha particles are rebounded. Why it happens? Why it happens means we know that not according to the J.J. Thomson model, basic atomic model. The atomic model contains nucleus in it and the electrons revolve around the nucleus. What will happen when a stream of alpha particles goes through hit on by free space in it, they doesn't got deflection. What happens if they strike the nucleus of that atom? They'll go by a small deflections. What happens if directly alpha particles goes through that nucleus? They'll rebound. Why they'll rebound, man? Yes. Why means, what is the nucleus charge? Positive charge. What is the alpha particle charge? Positive charge. When two positive charges will come, get too near, what will happen? They will ripple. We know that like charges ripple with each other, unlike charges attract with each other. This is the reason, but he didn't know. After making this experiment, he come to know what the observations, and this leads to fall a new atomic model. That is called Rutherford atomic model. Rutherford atomic model was developed in the year 1911, and Rutherford was New Zealand British physicist. His lifetime period is from 30 August 1871 to 19 October 1937. And as he said that atom consists of a central core, a concentrated area. That concentrated area with a filled with a positive charged particles, and that positively charged particles is called as nucleus. And that nucleus is surrounded by electrons which revolve around it. He said that. And he also said that nucleus and electrons are held together because nucleus contains positive charge, electrons contains negative charge. As I already said that unlike charges attract with each other. And here he defined their sizes. And when compared to the atom, the nucleus size is smaller. And here the size of the nucleus is 10 to the power of minus 14 to 10 to the power of minus 15 meters. And the size of atom is 10 to the power of minus 10 meters. As it is that the size of the nucleus is 10 to the power of minus 14 to minus 15 meters. And 10 to the power of minus 10 meter is the size of an atom. And here he said that atom as whole is electrically neutral, because he said that positive charges equal to the negative charges of an atom. So if the magnitude of the positive charge is equal to the magnitude of the negative charge, what will happen? Their magnitudes equal means what will happen? They become electrically neutral. He said that. This is about Rutherford atomic model. His limitations and drawbacks of Rutherford atomic model. According to electromagnetic theory of physics, we know that when electrons continuously radiating, what will happen? It will lose its energy and its speed goes on decreasing. It means, as he said that the electron revolve around the nucleus in a circular path, but it becomes later on a spiral path because they are not definite orbits. He said only for that they move in a circular orbits. But when it is goes on continuously radiating, what will happen? The nucleus will get attracted towards the electron and the electron fell into the nucleus and the atom will collapse. If the atom will collapse, what will happen? There is no use of this atomic model. So he doesn't explain the stability of an atom. He doesn't explain about the electrons in each orbit, means he doesn't define orbits, and the electron will collapse because the electron is continuously radiating, it goes on decrement of speed and energy. So these are the limitations and drawbacks of Rutherford atomic model. And later on, Bohr atomic model. So Bohr is a student of Rutherford. He is a student of Rutherford. While he explaining atomic model of Rutherford, he is very interested in that. He is very excited to know about what is an atom, how it was developed and for what purpose it is, and what are that orbits and what is that nucleus. He is very interested in that. But he didn't satisfy for his model, Rutherford model. Because the electrons revolve around the nucleus continuously means there is a loss of energy. He thought that, and he come up with a new model by making a little modifications in Rutherford atomic model, and that one we are discussing now. In the year 1913, he proposed his theory of an atomic model. Niels Bohr lifetime period is 7 October 1885 to 18 November 1962. He proposed in the year 1913 his theory, and Bohr is a Danish physicist. Postulates of Bohr atomic model. Postulate 1. Yes, I make this postulates into different points to make easy understanding. So, atom consists of a central core, and that central core is called as nucleus. According to Rutherford, he made that point. And next, the nucleus surrounded by electrons. Yes, this is also point of Rutherford model. But here is another new point, that is, he said that electrons revolve around the nucleus in certain circular orbits. They are non-radiating orbits. They are also called as defined orbits. They are also called as definite orbits. And that non-radiating orbits are also called as stationary orbits. And the centripetal force is provided by electrostatic force. What is centripetal and what is electrostatic force, ma'am? Centripetal force is a force where the electrons moves in a circular path and which attracted towards the center. And what is electrostatic force, ma'am? We know that the Coulomb attraction force of attraction is that the two charges will get attracted with the ratio of distance of square distance, that is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 by r square. So, and here he considered the positive charge as ze and the negative charge as magnitude of e, and by combining this and by equating this, they will become it as mv square by r is equal to kz e square by r square. What is k, madam? K is 1 by 4 by epsilon naught. And here m is mass of an electron and the radius is considered as r. Postulate 2. As I said that electrons revolve in non-radiating orbits, they doesn't lose energy. There is no decrement in speed. That's called as non-radiating orbits, and which are also called as stationary orbits. And he said that one point angular momentum, because they are revolving around the circular path, it contains some angular momentum with mass m, v and radius of the circular path is r. So here angular momentum is m, v, r. And here he said that angular momentum is integral multiple of h by 2 pi. What is h here? Planck's constant. And what is 2 pi? We know that it is also constant. So in this way he discussed about postulate 2. And here I am going to discuss the circular orbits. And that nucleus is present at the center of an atom. And that the center of an atom is surrounded by electrons in definite orbits. And that definite orbits are named as K, L, M, N. Or otherwise, they will define with numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. So which is very near to the nucleus is treated as K shell. And it followed by L, it followed by M, it followed by N. And later on, we can also define with this numbers 1 upon 2, 2, 3, 2 after 4. And this is about K, L, M, N and 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is about postulate 2. And again here, this is postulate 3. What is postulate 3? Electron jumps from one stationary orbit to another when their energy is applied. It means, as we said that the hydrogen is, actually Bohr discussed about the hydrogen atom, so that's why I used hydrogen. But before going to this, we have to discuss only the atomic model. As we know that nucleus is surrounded by electrons and they are K, L, M and shells. If it wants to jump an electron from one orbit to another orbit, it doesn't move itself. Then we have to apply energy. We need to apply energy for electron, then only it get excited. So here there are two types of things are there. One is emission and one is absorption. What is emission here? When electron jumps from high energy level to low energy level is called as emission. When electron jumps from low to high energy level is called as absorption. High to low is called as emission. Low to high is called as absorption. So emission does not need any energy, but absorption needs energy. It means the electron in the low orbit needs to apply h nu of amount of energy, nothing but a photon energy. It needs to get up with electron, then only electron move from one orbit to another orbit. It means low to high, low energy level to high energy level. It is called as absorption. And after that absorption, the electron present in the excited level will fall suddenly to the low energy level after a certain time of lifetime of period of an electron. And that one is called as emission, and low to high is called as absorption, high to low is called as emission. This is about postulate 3. And drawbacks of Bohr atomic model. Bohr could not explain those atoms more than one electron. As I said that he explained about only hydrogen because it contains only one electron in it. He doesn't explain about more than one electrons like helium, lithium, etc. He doesn't said about elliptical orbits of an atom. He doesn't explain about G-Mann effect, Stark effect. Why I'm stressing this, later on we'll discuss that only. And he doesn't explain intensity of spectral light. So these are the drawbacks of Bohr atomic model, in that we have to know about G-Mann and Stark effect, and we have to know about the spectrum, what is the spectrum and types of spectrum, and we have to know about the centripetal force and how that formula comes, and we have to know the Coulombic attraction of force, how that formula comes. So let's discuss centripetal force. Centripetal force is a force which move in a circular path, as I already said in Bohr atomic model. Here in that diagram, one person is revolving a weight which is tied up with a string. This is called as a sport hammer narrow. Hammer narrow. He uses to revolve that and he uses to throw it. So what happens? That force acts on a body which moves in a circular path and directed towards the center of body. Why it happens? Due to its weight, due to the mass of the stone, because it is very high. So definitely it will, we have to revolve with a very high force, and then it will drag towards, pull towards us. We are the center of that circular path. And that such type of action is called as centripetal force. So now come with another slide. Centripetal force, nothing but it derived from a Latin word. Here centrum means center, peter means to seek. It is the meaning of the centripetal force. So here it comes up with one formula, that is Fc is equal to mv square by r. What is Fc here? Centripetal force. What is m? Mass of the body, weight of that body. And next, v is velocity, r is radius of the circular path. So let's move. How to derive this? See that object is moving with a circular path, which makes an angle with theta, and it contains a radius. Yes, we know that. From center of the circle to arc of the circle is called as radius, and it will move with a certain velocity. Yes, there will be a direction change. Direction change means there will be a velocity change. If the velocity changes with respect to time, we call it as an acceleration. So by this we call we calculate the formula. Acceleration is called as centripetal acceleration. It comes like this: a is equal to v square by r. But actually the formula is mv square by r. No matter, we are derived only v square by r. So what happens? According to the Newton's second law, what is the formula? Force is equal to mass into acceleration. Yes, mass is constant, and acceleration formula came up here. What is that? V square by r. We have to produce that v square by r in that formula. It becomes F is equal to mv square by r. This is the centripetal force derivation. And we have to discuss Coulombic force of attraction. What is it? When two opposite charged particles come together, attracted together, is called as Coulombic attraction. Means different charges comes together with an attraction, because unlike charges attract with each other, and that action is called as Coulombic attraction. And Coulombic attraction depends upon two factors. First one is the electron, which is very near to the nucleus, contains strong attractive force. That was the first factor. The electron which is farther away from the nucleus contains weaker force. This is the second factor. So these are the two factors of Coulombic attraction. Coulombic attraction defined with one formula, that is force of attraction is inversely proportional to square of distance as to particles to and fro actions. And then force of attraction is directly proportional to the magnitude of charge. And this comes up with Coulomb attraction, force of attraction formula. And this is about the Coulombic force of attraction. And later on, we'll discuss spectrum and the types of spectrum. What is spectrum? Yes, it is here. A band of colors obtained by passing light through prism. When a light is going to hit a prism, it emits a band of colors, a group of colors. And that such action and that phenomenon is called as spectrum. Then spectrum divided into two types. What are they? First one, continuous spectrum. Second one, line spectrum. What is continuous spectrum? Yes. When a white light passes through a prism, what happens? It emits all Vijayar colors. Yes or not? But we didn't rectify which color is this. Yes, rainbow contains, we'll see only the red and green color, which is very visible to our eye. But it is a combination of all seven colors, because there is no gap in between the colors. They will emit when they hit the prism. And such spectrum is called as continuous spectrum. It means there is no clear cut boundary. There is no clear cut boundary. They'll combine together and comes up with prism. So that one is called as continuous spectrum. And continuous spectrum is obtained by condensed matter like solids, liquid compounds. And this spectrum is obtained by solids and liquids compounds. And line spectrum. And this is mainly come with gas performance. And what will happen, the light spectrum is nothing but there is no gap in between wavelengths of colors. Yes, definitely it is red. Definitely it is green. Definitely it is blue. So there is no clear cut boundary is called as continuous spectrum. If there is a clear cut off boundary which has separated the different colors, individual colors, is called as line spectrum. So this is about spectrum and types of spectrum. So this is about the continuous spectrum. And the light from the sun produce white light, and it is used to form all Vijayar colors without any gaps. And here one word is that incandescent. It is a filament bulb which gives a white light with a very low intensity. So by giving high temperatures, it will allow the white light to produce into the prism, and they'll emit all Vijayar colors. And this is about the continuous spectrum. Line spectrum, as I already said that. Line spectrum is also called as atomic spectrum or discontinuous spectrum, because the colors are come up with individual. So line and band spectrum. Why this happens means the excitation of an electron or de-excitation of an electron cause this line spectrum. So here, why it cause means there is an excitation of electron or de-excitation of an electron in atom. This produces line spectrum. And here comes with the line spectrum, band spectrum. Band spectrum is nothing but it consists of closed lines. The lines combination is called as band spectrum. And how do we recognize that it is line spectrum? Means it produced with lines, and the combination of lines is called as bands. Are called as bands. So this is about line and band spectrum, and comes up with types of line spectrum. So what are the types of line spectrum here? Emission spectrum and absorption spectrum. They divided into two types. When white light by a gas, when white light goes through a gas, they divided into two types. Here it is there. Based on white light, emission and absorption by gas. Based on white light only, there will be emission, there will be a gas. And they were divided into two types. What are they? Emission and absorption spectrum. So, emission spectrum and absorption spectrum. And I as discussed that what is emission and what is absorption. Yes, we discussed before. So how do we recognize it is an emission spectrum, ma'am? How do we recognize it is an absorption spectrum, ma'am? Means emission spectrum contains dark background with bright lines. Absorption spectrum contains white background with dark lines. In this way, you will recognize what is emission and what is absorption. So again, you want to know about what is emission and what is absorption. I have to say, here we'll discuss hydrogen emission spectrum. So if we discuss absorption and emission, we will get clear cut an idea of this emission spectrum. So what is emission? As I already said, when an electron in lower orbit move from low to high is called as absorption. When it comes from high to low is called as emission. So this is how what is an emission and what is an absorption. In this way, that emission of hydrogen will happen. Here we discuss the hydrogen emission spectrum. Here it is a gas producing line spectrum. So this is the diagram of hydrogen emission spectrum, which is not continuous because we know that line spectrum is a discontinuous spectrum. So by heating of gas, it radiates energy, then it moves through the slits and then hit it to the prism, then it will give all colors. How it give colors means, yes, when a white light is going to hit a discharge tube, or when white light emerges into the discharge tube, the hydrogen gas absorbs the wavelength, some amount of wavelengths from white light, and it is used to produce through slit, and it will hit the prism, then they will form. It only takes the sum of wavelengths, only sum of wavelengths of white light, then it will produce a line spectrum. Then this is called as it produce some wavelengths with into split, and that it's going to emit up. That's why it is called as emission spectrum. So this is the way we have done with this. So what is hydrogen spectrum? If you discuss the hydrogen spectrum wavelengths, we'll come up with that idea. So here we discuss the quantized electronic structure of an atom, and that will discuss or explain of the clear explanation of an hydrogen spectrum. Let's discuss. So hydrogen spectrum wavelength. So here there are 5 series. First one is Lyman, second one is Balmer, third one is Paschen, fourth one is Brackett, fifth one is Fun series. P is silent. So what is this means, madam? If the transition of, yes, I have to say no. Their central core is called as nucleus according to atomic model of Bohr, and they are surrounded by the electrons, yes. But they are in defined orbits, means indefinite orbits, what they are called KLM shells. So if K is considered as 1, L 2, M 3 and 4, as I define that shells are also 1, 2, 3, 4. If the shell 1 get a transition of energy to the shell 2 or shell 3, then we call it as Lyman series. Then second one, if shell 2 get a transition of energy with shell 3, shell 4 or otherwise any other shell, we call it as Balmer series. And next one, if the shell 3 got a transition of energy from third shell to fourth, and third shell to fifth, or third shell to sixth, or any other shell from third, is called as Paschen series. And next, Brackett series. If the fourth shell is giving a transition of energy from fourth to fifth, or fourth to sixth, or any other shell, is called as bracket series. What is fun series? If the fifth shell is making a transition of energy from fifth to sixth or fifth to seventh is called as P fun series. If it is from first, there is energy transition from the first shell, we called it as Lyman. Energy transition from the second shell, we called it as Balmer. Energy transition from third shell, we call it as Passion. Energy transition from fourth shell, we call it as Bracket. And energy shell from the fifth shell, transition from the energy from the fifth shell, we called it as Fun series. This is the hydrogen spectrum wavelength. Next, we have to discuss the G-Mann and Stark effect. What is G-Mann effect? He proposed this effect in 1902. What it means? The splitting of spectral lines into two or three components by applying magnetic field is called as G-Mann effect. Means the spectral line has to be split into three or more components by using the application of magnetic field. So such type of phenomenon is called as Z-Mann effect. Now Stark effect. If the spectral line divided into multiple components by applying electrical field is called as Stark effect. If it is by magnetic field, we call Z-Mann. If it is by electric field, we call it as Stark. It was proposed in the year 1919. And let's see differences between Stark and Z-Mann. So there is no discussion at all. The only main difference is Z-Mann magnetic field, Stark electric field. By reading this, we can get a clear cut idea of difference. Yes, splitting of spectral lines by magnetic field is called as Z-Mann. Splitting of spectral lines by electric field is called as Stark. Then it will be observed with magnetic field, it will by electric field, and there is an interaction of magnetic moment with external magnetic field, and there is an interaction of electric moment with the electric moment of an atom of the atom with an external electric field. These are the differences between G-Mann effect. So I'll give a small feedback lines of these atomic models what we discussed. So we discussed four atomic models. First one is, what is the first one? John Dalton theory. Second one is J.J. Thomson model. Third one is Rutherford atomic model. Fourth one is Bohr atomic model. After that we have quantum model in quantum physics, but we discussed up to Bohr model. So what do you observe from these models? You observed and you come up with some conclusion. What is an atom? What is an atomic model? Why it is important? And next here, how the science develops a hypothesis to develop anything around the world. Everything in the physics come up with the ideas of around the world. World contains of matter, that is physics. So you linked with these ideas. Yes, Greek philosophers gave the idea of atomos. So it was explained by John Dalton, and John Dalton theory make a proposal to of J.J. Thomson, and J.J. Thomson to Rutherford, Rutherford to Bohr atomic model. So this atomos is not a clear cut idea, but a hypothesis gave to develop a Bohr these four atomic models which we are reading now, which we are applying now. So this is my topic. I hope you understood all. Thank you for giving this opportunity. Thank you one and all.